Good morning.
Good morning.
We come together in the name of Jesus, our risen Lord. All the other things that have seemed to bother us, that divide us, that we cause to wonder who we are, we cast those aside in this moment, and we come together in His name. And one of the ways that we come together, and what we do when we're together in Him, is to identify where God is at work. And we find ways to go join God where God is at work. And one of the first ways I want to share with us of how God is at work, God continues to be at work excitedly among us with our consecration, with the time that we have spent building and getting ready to commit ourselves to the Lord, not only with our financial resources, but with everything that we are. And I want y'all to know that our financial secretary has got to be one of the happiest people I've ever met in the last couple of weeks. So I call that out, though, not to just say continue to be mindful of what God is doing in your hearts, but continue to be aware that what's happening here is transformational. And as God continues to work among us, to build us together, to work together as one body, that involves us continuing to engage with all that we are, including our finances. So again, I want to say thanks be to God for that. But there are many other ways in which God continues to be at work in our lives. I wanted to share that the youth are always active. The youth are always seeking out ways to serve the Lord. Today at 1 o'clock until 2:30, the youth are actually going over to Peachtree Village to do some service and ministry work over there. And Taylor wanted me to let all the youth know and youth families know that if you want to stay afterwards, he will provide lunch for those youth. So thank you, Taylor, for your leadership there and for seeing God at work over at Peachtree and going over there. We have other things that we see God at work in. One of the things I want to call to mind is Charge Conference is tomorrow night. It's a combined Charge Conference with most of the churches in the East Jackson District. So if, please come. Please come participate in the life of Charge Conference, 7 o'clock until around 8:30 at Christ United. This is an important part of what it is to be a Methodist, a United Methodist. And during that time, there will be a special offering taken up specifically for UMCOR, United Methodist Committee on Relief. They have been actively at work after all the hurricanes and disasters and flooding and things like that. So there'll be a special offering there at that time, but if any of you want to go ahead and designate or write a special additional check or donation for that, put it in the offertory plate, note it, or bring it by to Vicky's office tomorrow, and we will make sure that that gets deposited there. One of the ways that I love to see God at work is on a Wednesday nights. For those of you who don't come, you're missing out on a lot of fun. You're missing out on a lot of development. One of the things that we've started doing is watching the movie Luther. And it's a good updated version of it. In fact, it was so good that I got angry on Wednesday. I sat there in the back of the room and just started shaking after I saw what was going on in the life of the church at that time and the excesses and the abuses and the bad doctrine. And so come and participate in that. And I'll even make less salty popcorn than I did this last week. Apparently, I didn't realize that that was a tablespoon. That was way too much salt, even my mouth. My lips actually peeled after I ate that popcorn. I'll do my best. The last thing that I will say about how we see God at work, one of the ways in which God works is when we reach out. And we are going to be doing that on the Sunday prior to Halloween, so this next Sunday. We're doing a trunk or treat, but it's also a mission fair. And this is important for all of us to know that we can invite young children and families to come and participate in some fun activities out here along the parking lot. But also, it's a time for any ministry that you're involved in, from Sunday school class to an outreach program that you're a part of, anything that you're doing, including even the yard crew. Set up a trunk. Let us show one another how we see God at work in our lives, how we see God at work in this church. Because it's important for us to proclaim that it is God doing the work and that God has made us able to this task. It is God's work. It is God's transformation. So let us now turn our hearts and minds to worship. Please join me in our call to worship. Power and might and majesty belong to God, who created and is creating. Like the image of a powerful wind and the heavens as a garment, God's majesty is revealed in all creation. Who are we that God should pay attention to us?
We are God's fellow children, the stewards.
Amen.
Let us rise and join our voices in our opening hymn of praise. I sing the almighty power of God. Hymn number 152. Show your majesty. As we gather today to celebrate your love and creation, keep us mindful that we are part of that created order. Prepare us to live in you as you created. And in so doing, help us to be the kind of disciples that serve you faithfully. For we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may be seated.
We are indeed part of God's created order. Part of it. All of us. Individually and together. And in that created order, God comes to us and says, let me hear what's on your heart. Let me hear what's going on in your lives. And so we cry out to God because God asks us to. And in that conversation, and in that time, when we cry out these names, God is with us. God joins us. So we celebrate here. This rosebud. We celebrate what we have going on in the life of our church, that in honor of the birth of Sellers Bennett Debusson, proud parents Clara, Kara, and Nick, for Catherine Walker's third birthday, we give thanks. But we also have those concerns for Bob Zweers, for Judy Aikens, Jean Carroll, Martha Sanderson, the family of Roy Lunn, Elizabeth Harris, for Cicely and June Martin. We come to God in prayer.
Given by the cross.
Let us pray. To the majesty and glory of your name, Almighty Father, we give you thanks for the way in which you call us to you. It causes us to wonder, why are you mindful of us? But you still come. You come to us, and we give you thanks for the way in which you bring us life, for the way in which you cause us to praise you, for your salvation, for your redemption, for your sanctification. We give you thanks. As your children, we offer from our lips praise to you. And because we trust you as Father, we know that we can come to you with the words that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have a moment now of celebration, a moment of acknowledging some of the women in our United Methodist women. And though she is nervous, I promise you, I love her voice. So if you would explain to everybody what's going on.
Each year, the United Methodist women give a special mission recognition pin. This pin offers a meaningful way to honor members who have dedicated so much time and effort to serve. It is my honor to award this special mission recognition pin this year to Lisa Toney and Christy Brantley. Would you please come?
This is no small thing that the United Methodist women do. Know that these women are actively at work in the Lord's name, not only serving women and children and youth, but they are passionately trying to bring us all back to that relationship with Christ that is so important for all of us. So hands of love, hands of service, all seeking Christ's presence. And so I commend to you, Crossgates United Methodist Church, your United Methodist women, and I encourage you, younger women, this is a place for you to grow, to connect, to thrive in your faith. So do not shy away. Come be a part of this. Thanks be to God.
This morning, our scripture reading comes from the Old Testament, the book of Job, chapter 38, verses 1 through 7, and then 34 through 41. Then the Lord answered Job out of a whirlwind. Who is this that darkens the counsel with words without knowledge? Gird up your loins like a man, and I will question you. And you shall declare to me, where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Tell me if you have understanding. Who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched out a line upon it, on where its bases are sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? When the morning star sang together, and all the heavens shouted for joy. Can you lift up your voice to the clouds? So that a flood of waters may cover you? Can you send forth lightnings so that they may go and say to you, here we are? Who has put wisdom in the inward parts or given understanding to the mind? Who has the wisdom to number the clouds? Or who can tilt the waterskins of the heavens? And when the dust runs into mass and clods and cling together, can you hunt the prey for the lion or satisfy the appetite of the young lions when they crouch in their dens or lie in wait in their covert? Who provides the raven its prey when its young one cries to God and wander for lack of food? And this is the word of God for us, the people of God.
As our ushers are coming forward to help us with the offertory, we have a special act of worship and offering today through these beautiful voices. But I want to remind you again that because God's grace is transforming us, we are now able to be gracious with all that we are, with all that's in our pocket, with all that's in our heart, and with all the time that we have. Let us be generous.
Waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds you, you've never failed, and you won't start now. And I will call. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you are mine. Oh. Keep my eyes. above the waves. My soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours, and you are mine.
I am yours, and you are mine.
Mark chapter 10. Now James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to him, "Teacher, we want you to do for us whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "Okay, what is it that you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit one at your right and one at your left in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You don't know what you're asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?" And they replied, "Sure, we're able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the 10 heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. So Jesus called them and said to them, "Now you know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as their rulers lord it over them, and their great ones are tyrants over them. But not so among you. Whoever wishes to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave to all. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. You may be seated. I was about 7 years old. I was standing on the porch of the house I grew up in Fort Worth, Texas. Spring afternoon, already getting kind of warm, and there was my dad out front with a lawn boy, getting it cranked, ready to mow. And I ran out to my dad. Said, "Dad, I want to mow. I want to mow." He said, "Are you sure? Are you able? Do you know how?" I said, "Yeah." So I took that lawnmower, and the lawn boy, for those of us who know what that is, has an automatic drive on it. You push the handle up on it. And I took up, pushed the handle up, and it took off, and it drug me all over the yard. And I was just going all over the place. Look at me, I am mowing the grass. Woohoo! Just mowing it all over the place. And finally, I said to my dad, I'm done. Oh, no, you're not. He said, start on the curb and go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth. So I did, and I realized it's not fun anymore going back and forth. So I got done. Whew. That machine dragging me around all over the front yard. My dad said, okay, backyard. What? Was I able to mow as a 7-year-old? Sure, I was able. I wasn't able. But I was able, but I wasn't able. Right around that same time, I remember my sister, Stephanie, my older sister. She has a rebellious streak about her, and I love her for it even to this day. But when she was about that age, a little younger, she had a stewardess uniform from Delta. Every time my grandparents flew in, they'd always fly in on Delta, so she had a stewardess uniform. Well, she would get mad at something that I did, my parents did, and she'd pack up all her stuff. And she says, I'm moving out, I'm leaving, I'm running away. And about 4 times a year, she would head out, go about 3 houses down, past the Carver's house, and she may even go into the Carver's house. And my parents would just, okay, see you in a little bit. Let me help you pack. Are you able, Stephanie, to go in on your own? Are you ready to go and live on your own? Are you able? Yes, I am. And then she'd come back. Are you able? Interestingly, my older sister Stephanie was the last one of us to leave the home, even though she wanted to leave the home first than anybody else. Are you able? Was an 8-year-old able to leave, become a stewardess, take all of her belongings in her little bitty bag and go and become free and independent? No. Would she eventually be? Yes. Are you able? When we first moved here to Mississippi, I was lonely, had no friends. Look, I was redheaded, I was freckle-faced. I was a preacher's kid, I was scrawny. I was lonely. So my parents said, what if we got you a dog? So they took me to the shelter. And I looked at all the different dogs, and they're all cute, and then one got loose. Her name was Pepper. She was half Lhasa, half Cocker, half everything else. Yes, I know that I said 3 halves. That was Pepper. And she just started going crazy, and I loved her. And she loved me. And for 16 years, she was my best friend. Always loyal. But was I able, as a 12-year-old, to take care of all the responsibilities of a dog? Are you sure, Trey? Yeah, I'm able. Are you sure? Are you ready to, you're going to bathe her? Oh, every day. You're going to feed her? Yeah, I'll make sure she's fed. You gonna exercise her? Mm-hmm. Now, I played with Pepper. We went on long hikes. I may have bathed her 5 times in 16 years. Was I able? Did I always put the food in the bowl when she was hungry, or did I just give her food off the table? I mean, yeah. Was I able to be responsible for a dog who was totally dependent upon me? Sure. No. Yeah. I was able. I remember my first car. My first car was a 1979 four-door maroon Chevette. Chevy Chevette. Beautiful maroon on the outside, faded pink on the inside. It's a beautiful car. The sun visors were all falling off. Beautiful car. Stick shift, though. I knew how to drive a stick shift. And my parents said, are you sure? Are you able? Yeah, I can do this. And I drove that car, and I got to learn how to drive it right. And I was on the other side of town hanging out with my girlfriend, and I realized it was coming up on time to come home. And I thought, I got 5 minutes to make it across town. I can make it. And guess what I got? A ticket. Was I able to drive? Yeah. Was I really able? No. When I got home, I was just in tears. I knew I'd failed everybody, God and my parents and society. And I showed my parents the ticket, and they said, "Are you able to pay it?" "No." "Are you able to go to traffic school?" "Yeah, I guess so." "Are you able to bear the responsibility of driving a car?" "Yes." "Are you able? Be careful what you ask for. Are you able?" About 26 years ago, Missy and I stood before God and all the assembled witnesses, and we professed our love and commitment to one another, to love, cherish, honor, and obey for all the days of our life till death do us part. Are you able to make that promise? Come on, guys, those of us who've been married, did we really know what we were doing? Seriously, did you really know what you were doing? Yeah, yeah, there's a lot of this. Were you able, Missy? Were we able? Yeah. No. Yes. I don't know. Yes. What about having kids? Do we know what in the world we were getting ourselves into? No. Have we been able? Yeah. No. No. Yes. Are we able? Yes. Do you really know what you're getting yourself into? Rusty, do you know what you're getting yourself into? No. That's part of it. You got to get into it. And thank goodness Donna didn't. And thank God Donna didn't know. That's exactly right. Y'all need to, by the way, come on Wednesday nights, because that's part of the funny thing is that Rusty will say something, and then we'll all look over at Donna to see if it's true, or to see if she's laughing, or whether there's going to be trouble that night on the way home. She's in Virginia. We'll have to verify that when she gets back next week. Are you able? Are you able? When I was 11 years old, I knew I needed Jesus. I was so afraid of dying. There's a movie that came out called The Day After. It was on TV. It's about nuclear war. And I watched that, and I was so afraid of death, of war, of dying. And I knew that there was something that others did in church. And they came forward and they said, "Jesus, I want to publicly follow you. Hey, church, would you help me?" And I did, and I came forward. And I was baptized. And I professed my faith in Christ. And I was asked, "Do you want to follow Jesus?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm able." Was I able? Yes? No? Yes? Is the one whom I was at 11 the same as I am today? No. Is that commitment that I made then valid? Yes. Did I know what in the world I was getting myself into to the point where I'd be standing here with you? No. Was I able? Yes. Was God able? Oh, yes. Even more so. And in the life of this church over the last several months, with lay leader engagement, with Rusty taking the spearhead on this, we have gone through a time of consecration, of preparing ourselves to respond to God's grace and also to respond to where is this church going to go to find God at work, and how are we going to do that, and what resources do we need? Human resources, financial resources, time resources. And we said 2 Sundays ago, we're able. We made our commitments. We're still making our commitments. I encourage you, continue to make your commitment. But are we able? Are we able? Yes? No? Maybe? Yeah. And what's important to know in these scripture readings that we've heard today is that the Job reading reminds us our position. It reminds us in all these commitments, when we say we are able, we are reminded, be careful if you say we too firmly or I too firmly. In the book of Job, Taylor and I have had a lot of fun this week going through this book of Job and all the different characters, and he's mad. He's mad at a few of them because he wants them to be firmer with him, or just tell him to buck it up, buttercup, and get over it. But see, Job is an interesting story. At the very beginning of it, we hear very clearly God declaring Job has done nothing wrong. Nothing at all. Now, please understand that this is a story. That in Christ, we know that God does not throw lightning bolts. He's not Zeus. He doesn't try to trip us up. But in this story, the Satan, not the dragon, this prosecuting attorney comes up and says, I bet you that if you strip away everything this man has, he won't be faithful. And God said, I think he's able. I think he's able. Take everything but his life. And so the story begins to unfold, and all the people around them begin to come and say, hey, Job, it's obvious that you've done something wrong because you are unhealthy, because you've lost everything. His friends said, confess even if you're not sinful. His wife said, just go ahead and curse God and die. And here's Job lying there on the ground in pain, agony, asking God, please let me die. I will never, though, say something that isn't true. I will never say something that is against my character. I know, God, I didn't do anything. And out of this moment, a giant whirlwind blows through, and there's God. And he communes with Job, and he tells Job this. Job, were you there at the beginning? Were you there at the very beginning when I was laying the foundations? Were you there when the stars were being put in their place? Were you there when the animals were being created and apportioned to what they were going to be doing in the world? Were you there? Was this something that you understand? So be careful, Job. And God's not being critical here. He's just being gracious and reminding, Job, there is so much more than you can realize. I love you. And I'm amazed at your faithfulness. But please understand this. It's not all about you. I got other things going on. And that doesn't mean I don't love you or that I don't care for you. But be careful. Know your place. Because within that place, you will find your place. And right after that, we hear Job on his knees saying, I repent, not of doing anything wrong. I repent of the fact that I saw you with my eyes. I did not know you with my heart. And in that moment, his life was changed because he knew his place. He trusted God to be God. And he decided to fully live there. And when he fully lived in that relationship with God, and when we fully live into our relationship, what we know as in Christ, we are able. We're able to undergo the trial. We're able to undergo the loss because we know that God is with us. We know that God has not abandoned us because we're able. Because God is able. We have this hilarious story. James and John, the sons of Zebedee. I am so thankful that we have these characters of Jesus' 12 closest friends. Because if it were not for them, I would think I was an utter failure as a follower of Jesus. Yet Jesus' closest 12. Would you really imagine going up to Jesus and saying, hey, Jesus, hook me up. I need to ask you a favor. Special favor. I want one of us to be over here on this side, and one of us over here when you have all your power and authority. And Jesus said, oh, really? Do you now? Are you really ready for this? Are you ready to drink this cup? Are you ready to be held under in this baptism that I'm going to go under? Now, we all know he's talking about his sacrifice of his blood and his baptism into death. And what is their response? Yeah, we're able. We can do this. Sure we can. And Jesus said, okay, guess what? You are able. You are able. And you will drink that cup, and you will be in that baptism as well. And in that moment, Jesus knew what he was talking about. They had no idea. But think about it at the end, the story, Paul Harvey's end of the story, the rest of the story. They all were able to go all the way. All of them drank that cup, and all of them experienced that baptism into their death and then eventual life in Christ. They were able. But when these others, these 10, saw what was going on, they got angry. I think rightly so. And they came to Jesus, and Jesus actually brought them in and said, okay, let's sit down and talk. Guys, let me make this clear to you, that the godless people of the world use power and authority to lord it over. Thumb down, push it down. Tyrants of the world use their power in strong and tough and mighty ways. And they push you down. But not so among you. I love that little phrase. Do me a favor, pop it out, stick it into your brain. The Christian life, not so among you. We are different. We are transformed people. We don't act like the godless world does. Well, how does that mean we act? If you want to become great, you got to be a servant. You want to be first, you might as well be a bondservant to somebody. Take the position of the servant. For the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Are we able to follow Jesus? Yes. No. Maybe. Yes. Yes, we are. Because God is able. And we become willing. And we become servants. And in this act of transformation, we find ourselves and we know who we are in Christ. That we are truly important individually. But we're not everything. And thanks be to God, Rusty, that it's not all on my shoulders and it's not all on your shoulders. And choir, our beautiful worship leaders, it's not all on your shoulders. But you're able. And you're able. And you're able. All of you are able. Not to stand up and say, look how strong and mighty I am, but we're all able to do what? Serve. We just recognized UMW service. We've recognized others throughout worship over the past several weeks of ways in which they have joined God at work. We've embarked upon a campaign in this church of stewardship, of commitment, of all that we are. And are we able? Yes. Yes, we are. Because we're ready and willing to serve. And I know that we're able. And I know that you're able, and I know that I'm able, because the test is not greatness. The test is service. And so, I commend to you one person who has already demonstrated that he gets it. Wednesday night, I was cooking popcorn. Trying to, at least. Throwing too much salt in there, popping that thing, smoking up the place, and I'm just doing my best to keep it going and keep it going. And Ben Eichelberger came up to me, and he said, can I help? And I said, are you able? Do you know how to do this? Yeah? Well, no, he couldn't reach it. Little stirring thing, and the popcorn was flying everywhere. And I said, well, come here. Stand here, and let me show you how to scoop it. And he began to scoop. 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 I said, okay, you're good. I'm going to pop one last batch. Yeah, I can do this. I'm able. And he scooped. And he came to me when he was done. He said, I'm done. I said, well, you go take that popcorn, and you go put it in that room so the people can enjoy it. He was able because he served. He was able because he saw, I guess, his pastor in great need. And he came and he said, I am able to help you. I want to serve. See, it's that simple. Serve. Get on your knees, wrap the towel around your waist, serve. Find your place. Find the thing that you are drawn to and serve. This church is full of that life, full of God at work. Already, almost all of you have found a way to plug in, but now is the time. Today is the day for you to say, I am able. I am. No, I'm not, but maybe, but yes, I am able. I am. And that is the call of commitment that I ask of you and of me, that even if you feel like the lawn boy is dragging you all over the yard, you are able. And one day you will be able to mow the grass without your dad having to help you. And one day you can look back and say, I guess I was able to get married and have kids. I guess I was able to commit my life to Christ. Hey, church, I guess we are able to commit all of ourselves to God and become the church that we are called to be. And so I invite us now in our response to sing a song called Are Ye Able? And it is a beautiful song and a challenging song. You are invited to respond, a response of saying, yes, I am able, because God, I know that you are. Let us stand. Let us sing together.
So many were. They suffered, they died, they gave a lifetime of dedication to the love of their heart, Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, if you haven't figured it out by now, the church is not for the wimpy. It's not for those who whine. If that's who you are, it's the world that's calling you. For no matter how much you want to be able, you can reach as deep within you as you can, and you can't find the stuff. It only comes from our Father in heaven with his love, the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, and the power of that Holy Spirit. So, you beautiful and wonderful saints of God, it's time now to go out in the world, to sing your song, to wear your colors, to tell your story, to hold high the cross. So you go now with the love of God, the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, and always remember you never ever go alone, but always in company of his Holy Spirit. Go now with urgency, and go now in peace. Amen.